Hello and welcome to this webinar titled Implementing CMC Strategies for Scale-Up Operations in Biologics Manufacturing, hosted by Biopharma Asia magazine and presented by Anita Krishnan, Assistant Director and Head of CMC Development and Global Biosimilars at Lupin, and Anu Upal, Manager of Biopharmaceutical Applications at AB SciX. My name is Stephen Edwards and I will be your moderator. Now, please allow me to introduce our first presenter, Anita Krishnan. Dr. Anita Krishnan presently heads a team that is responsible for physicochemical and functional characterization of biosimilars at Lupin. She is a key contributor towards the CMC of regulatory submissions to PMDA, EMA, US FDA, TGA, Health Canada, and others for several biosimilars. She is one of the core mass spec experts in India who specializes in the field of advanced characterization of biomolecules and is a key opinion leader in MS software algorithms for multiple mass spec manufacturers. She has wide experience in the field of biosimilars and plasma therapeutics and has earlier worked at Intas Biopharmaceuticals and Celestial Biologicals. She was a recipient of DBT BIPP research grant at Celestial Biologicals and the INSA grant as a graduate student. She has many publications to her credit and guides graduate students for PhD. She obtained her doctorate in biotechnology from the collaborative research conducted at IICT and CCMB Hyderabad as a CSIR fellow. I will now be handing over to our first presenter. Welcome, Anita.
Thank you, Stephen. Thanks for the kind words. And a big welcome to the audience who have registered. A very good day to you, some morning, some evening, some afternoon. I will be walking you through a few slides, giving you an outline of CQA identification for a successful a CMC strategy for biosimilars. There have been some recent trends regarding the way all of this culminates into a successful regulatory filing. I will be outlining a few of these expectations from different regulatory agencies. Also trying to look at a summary of how a good biosimilar development takes place. But first to just introduce the company that I work for. Lupin is the fourth largest generic pharmaceutical company globally by market capitalization. Lupin Biotech specifically, Lupin Pharma is very huge and we are a small, we have a small space in Lupin Pharma. Lupin Biotech entered into a strategic joint venture agreement with the Japanese pharmaceutical company Yoshindo and we created something called Vial Biologics in the year 2014. And that's how our first biosimilar went global. We recently also entered into a partnership with Mylan USA, again for global business development for launch of biosimilars. The map that is there on the slide shows our presence all over the world. We are a transnational company having business almost in every continent of the world. So now to go to the topic, the first slide just gives you a snapshot of all the elements of a successful biopharmaceutical development. If you look at the entire gamut of actions, in fact, I have actually classified this into five or six major steps. If you look at the left side of the panel, you have the quality target product profile, which is the first step towards initiation of biopharmaceutical development. Quality target product profile, in fact, forms the basis of design for development of the product. The QTPP essentially looks at or takes inputs from all the platform knowledge that's available in terms of similar kind of family of molecules or the specific molecule. Product understanding, which comes over a large years of experience in general about biopharmaceutical development. Product understanding which also comes from scientific literature. That's about the key first step. The quality target product profile for a new drug or a new biological drug would normally have all of this requirement. For a biosimilar drug, the quality target product profile will also involve the range finding for the innovator molecule against which you are proposing to prepare the biosimilar. So that's an addition for a biosimilar. The second step would be, once you have the target product profile, which is going to deliver a product, which is also going to give you the mechanism of action to treat your patients, once you have the target in hand, what you would like to know about this molecule is the critical quality attributes, because this will be required for you to manufacture the product, develop a process to reach the endpoint, which is your quality target product profile. Determining critical quality attributes comes with some amount of background knowledge and some amount of experimental testing of different quality attributes, looking at their impact over clinical safety and efficacy, which will be through functional assessments. The third step in this successful biopharmaceutical development would be to design your process such a way that it will give you the best quality, and your guide here will be your CQA determination. You will develop a process which will give you the right quality and also a good business component, a good yield of the product. So when you have these two goals in mind, you would arrive at a combination of all the right elements which will reach you arrive at the goal. So process characterization studies that you do through either design of experiments or through multiple different methodologies are available, you would try to understand how your process behaves. In fact, you will try to understand the process capability and how best you will be able to apply control strategies. Now, the design space, once you understand the process, you will define your design space, you will identify your critical process parameters, and you will also link all your process parameters to and critical material attributes to all the CQAs that you have identified in a bit to actually come with a successful development of your biologic. Now, to do this, you will have to have a good control strategy or testing strategy, which means you need to have really high technology in terms of analytical methods, which are highly sensitive, accurate, precise, and it will give you the information and guide you towards this complete development. So the design and implementation of a control strategy using a risk management approach will be highly directed or will be highly guided by really good, strong, robust, accurate methods. The testing strategy does not just control only the process control strategy. It will also finally be used to show the analytical similarity which you need to establish against the innovator molecule. The last but not the least is, after you have the product in hand, you also still have the entire life cycle, because you're going to commercialize this product and run it for several years, so you will be doing continuous process verification, and this will be the last and the infinite step, which doesn't have any end. So these are the major basic elements of a successful biopharmaceutical development. My talk is just going to highlight, of course, this is a very huge area and it would be very vague to touch upon all of this. So the scope of this talk would be to look at the second and the fifth element, which is, how do you define the critical quality attributes and how do you integrate this into your testing strategy? So element two and element five is what the talk is all about. Moving on to the next slide. Here we are talking about how do we actually do the CQA assessment and criticality scoring. This is a very familiar AMAP case study where one of the tools are described. Essentially, most of the tools talk about the same, the scoring pattern, and the intricacies may be different, but what you're looking here essentially is the tool number one is looking at the impact assessment. When you talk about impact, you're talking about impact on just the biological activity or efficacy of the molecule. You will also be looking at whether there is an impact on the pharmacokinetic behavior. So serum clearance is again a very major component of the outcome of your drug. So that's another aspect which you will be looking at. The third one is again part of safety, which is immunogenicity. Considering these are huge molecules, biologics, injecting such kind of biologic would elicit an immunogenic response if it's not understood and controlled well. So you will also be looking at what's the impact of the molecule, what is the impact on immunogenicity aspect of your molecule. Safety aspect is about adverse effects, whether you are ending up with reversible, irreversible, manageable adverse effects. So if you look at the scale, you have a scale of anywhere between 2 to 20 and 5 different categories of impact. And you can see that each of these scores comes with a particular strength of impact, whether it's a moderate change, whether it gives you a significant change. So you could actually classify each of them into this big matrix that has been provided. Now, having said this, you may not have all the information in hand when you actually do the CQA assessment when you start the biological development. So it means there is an uncertainty component attached to every attribute. In some of the attributes, you may have a lot of information. It may be a common attribute impacting most of the biologics or a particular family of biologics. So the information at hand is very high. But in some cases, you may have a high level or high degree of uncertainty which may not allow you to classify it according to the tool number one on the left, the matrix on the left. So in those cases, you'll give a higher weightage on uncertainty so that it becomes high risk and you keep looking at it and keep foraging for information about this particular attribute which you do not have complete control. However, if you see the strength of the scoring pattern, uncertainty component is certainly on the lower side as compared to the impact assessment. It means it will not give undue weightage to a particular attribute just because you do not know anything about it. So from this matrix, from a matrix from the left and the right, if you find the product of this, you would probably end up with a higher score of 7 into 20, which may be around 140, or you may end up with something which is 2 into 1, which will be just a minimum score of 2. So your score for each attribute will be spread from 2 to 140. And once you categorize all of your attributes between the score of 2 to 140, what is outstanding now is where do you place the cutoff? What is the threshold for you to say what is more critical, what is less critical? So let's go to the next slide to look at that. So the criticality scoring, the way you want to cut it off, actually can be of different types. So this has been discussed earlier also, multiple models are available. So you have to customize this to the product, to the amount of experience you have, various different factors are involved here. So you can see there are multiple models here. Model number one, so all the models are scoring impact versus uncertainty, impact on the x-axis and uncertainty on the y-axis. And you can see that a score of 2 is placed as low and low, both sides, and a score of 140 is placed at high and high on the other side of the plot. And as and when you are getting more information or you are getting more results of targeted experiments, you can move these attributes either higher or lower. So that's what happens in this first model. In the second model, this is something where your uncertainty level is not there at all. You don't have any uncertainty. You're not looking at anything about uncertainty. You know everything about the molecule. So you want to keep everything as high and low based on just your impact. So there is no component of uncertainty. So these are for molecules which are well characterized, well published. There's nothing unknown about this molecule. So those kind of molecules come on this. Molecules where you don't know anything, you would put all of them as, very high because now you don't know anything. You're starting with a clean slate And when you start, you have no idea about the molecule, which is more impactful, which has a clinical impact. All you know is that you want this drug to do this job. So in this kind of a model, you will put everything as highly critical. So it goes so on and so forth. There are multiple models. So the point I'm driving across in this slide is that you have to know what is your goal and customize your approach scientifically towards that goal and also justify it based on information that's available or generate information that will give you that justification. So that's the way it needs to progress. We can now move on to look at what exactly are these CQAs. When we say quality attributes, what are these quality attributes and what is critical among them? So you have product variants, which are essentially your product itself with some kind of modifications in terms of desired modifications, undesired modifications, a whole lot of them are there. So these are all product variants. Because you are using a cell-based system to produce your molecule, and you're dumping a whole lot of media, a whole lot of nutrition into the cell culture model, you may end up with a lot of process-related impurities, something which is generated by the process itself. So these are categorized under process-related impurities. There are certain CQAs which are considered as obligatory. Most of them, the obligatory CQAs are closest to the patient, which means the drug product attributes, everything about the drug product becomes an obligatory CQA just because it is the closest to the patient, right from the color to the pH, the composition, the strength, in the general appearance of the drug product. These are by default classified as very high risk, and there is no ranking that really is required for such kind of obligatory CQAs. Apart from that, there are some raw materials and leachable compounds which are innate to the process, innate to the drug product itself, where a typical CQA ranking is probably not required. Here you're looking at if you are dumping this much of whatever is your additive or excipient or anything that you're adding into it, what would be the estimated daily intake? So the ratio between the EDI to TTC is what actually defines whether this is a high-risk attribute or a low-risk attribute. So one of the ways to look at it is to look at the complete amount and then you divide it by the minimum need, or you go by the worst-case scenario where you assume that everything goes through the process. So that's another way of looking at it. So that's a different category of quality attributes, which also comes under critical quality attributes. Now the cartoon on the right tells you how you start with a QTPP, how you add all of these potential CQAs. You look at all the quality attributes which can potentially be critical. After you have a hypothesis in hand, you investigate in terms of generating these isolated variants. You either isolate them, you collect it from chromatographic separation, or you generate it as post-degradants and then look at the structure-function relationship. So the very important thing that you need to do early during development is to put your hands over these kind of variants, either by natural manner or by unnatural manner. You can even take some batches with very high pH, low pH, just to generate all of these variants, and then look at the structure-function link. This will upfront, right in the beginning, give you data where you can be very sure that these are either critical or non-critical. So this really makes your job very easy to have a very determined, designated, clear CQA list in hand. I would just like to, when I said you have to look at the structure-function link, this is not possible if you don't have all the analytical tests and the relative potency tests in place. If you do not have them in hand, this kind of an assessment is nearly impossible. So the first thing that you need during the development is really highly sensitive, apt, relevant analytical methods and assays. So is it possible to look at all kinds of analytical methods? Wouldn't that be a big testing burden and it would be really overwhelming? Yes, it will be. which means that you should know when to use a really detailed method and when do you use something called a regional assay. The concept of regional assay is nothing but a surrogate assay or a more simpler method, which will still give you a gross idea about what you are looking at. For example, slide number 7, you have the challenges of CQA assignment can be overcome to some extent by the use of regional assays. The example that I'm showing here, this is a molecule which has splits, which has misfolds, which has aggregates. So you see there is a simple peak profile that has been provided here, peak number 1, 2, and 3. So 1 corresponds to those degradants on the left, and 3 corresponds to the misfolds and aggregates that are present in the lower panel. Now, if you have such a profile, you may want to know what kind of misfolds are there, what kind of splits are there. You may want to look at it more in detail with LC-MS technology, which is on the right, which shows you the complications of looking at in detail these variants. You have a number of different types of bonds. You can have a whole gamut of disulfide bonds. You can have interpeptide bonds. You can have intrapeptide bonds. You can have both inter and intrapeptide bonds. So it's a huge maze. Now, if you start screening every combination of your process step with these kind of assays, you probably would take 10 to 15 years to complete your product development, so which is not feasible. So what you would do is you will map the profile on the left, which can be easily generated, to the profile on the right, so that you know that if I look at this is what I'm looking at it in detail. So initial mapping studies, if they are established early on, then you can use the regional assays to with a lot of confidence. May not be 100% confident, but to a large or adequate level of confidence, you can use the regional assays in your development process. Now, just to look at a little more on the disulfide bond, which is again a critical aspect here, because these kind of different combinations of disulfide bonds actually creates a good tertiary structure, a good surface topology for the molecule, and which actually is very important for the business of the molecule, which is binding the ligand. So in terms of the functional competence of the molecule, this structure is really important. This structural attribute is really important for the molecule's function. So what are the challenges for looking at such kind of intricate structural attributes? So a little on the way one can look at all the disulfide bond patterns, you could use multiple different ways to reduce this complexity. You can use a combination of proteolytic enzymes, which means you need to assess the sequence, the amino acid sequence of your molecule at hand, design the combinations of enzymes that you would want to digest this molecule to bring down the complexity to something that is manageable. You will also want to look at multiple alkylating agents so that you can look at the free cysteine marks. That's another way in which you can look at. You will also want to run complementary reducing and non-reducing maps to look at which peaks vanish from reducing to form which peaks in non-reducing, to look at which are the peptides that are actually bonded. You may also want to use different modes of fragmentation as you go further down into looking at which cysteine is bonded to which cysteine. You may want to have very rich fragmentation data. It means you have to use both CID as well as ETD kind of fragmentation wherever it is needed. For all of this, you will need very powerful data mining software, because this is going to generate a whole list of masses. Mass spec just gives you masses. It's all about how you infer what you can from this big list of masses. So all of this, you may have to have the technology in hand. Obviously, you will not have all of this technology when you start the product, which means a regional assay or a surrogate assay is the solution for you to initiate product development, but very soon you need to have all of this mapped so that you are able to understand what kind of complexity you have in hand. Now, does all this work really help, or are you just doing it to publish papers? Answer is no. establishing the structure-function relationship really, really matters. There's just one example there from one of the biosimilars that have been submitted. So that shows on the left side, it shows a correctly bonded molecule, and on the right side bottom, it shows a incorrect bonded peptide. And you can see that the percentage of this peptide has been plotted against the potency. And when you see the percentage of this scrambled disulfide bond, as it increases, you can see the potency is dropping down significantly. It means there is a direct correlation of this attribute, structural attribute, to potency. And this is exactly the kind of knowledge we would want to have to designate an attribute as either critical or non-critical. So technology, when works hand in hand with process, can actually come up with a very efficient and a process that really delivers on its expectations. The next slide, we're just looking at what happens in the general scenario, in the process scenario. Again, we go back to process, looking at, you start with CQA, and then you move on to looking at your process capability. Once you know what's your process capability, what kind of impurities or variants you are removing, what is possible of the process, and then you design your testing strategy, and then you go back, testing strategy goes back to define and confirm, yes, this is indeed your CQA, and all of these components put together actually give you an overall CQA and a risk-based product development and a control strategy. Would just like to move on to the next slide, which shows the biosimilar development strategy, which tells you how does it pan out in terms of the chronology of development. So it looks at a typical five-year-old plan, where you start with developing the analytical methods and you look at the initial targets. That is the time you are establishing your process, your cell line, and your QTPP, everything. And you're also looking at originator fingerprinting, which means you're procuring your innovator lots and looking at the ranges of these different quality attributes, which your process needs to handle and bring it to that particular level in the biosimilar product. You may have the second stage or the first analytical comparability may come around the stages where you're taking your product to the clinics, maybe the phase one and then the phase three. You may want to have analytical comparability established in these phases against your innovator product and the product that you're taking to clinics. And your final analytical comparability is when your complete control strategy is in place and you indeed have a consistent process and you're validating your process and you want to have a final analytical comparability. Now, if you see the last circle, you see the originator specs is much wider than the biosimilar specs. So the expectation here is the biosimilar is much tighter and much stringent, more stringent than the originator. To reach this goal, we need to have the best of technology put into the process development and the best of technology put into the analytical estimation, which really guides the process. To give you an idea about what kind of analytics and what kind of process is the expectation, I will show you the outcome of a good, successful development. Slide number 12 is showing you the quality range comparison between a reference and a biosimilar. If you look at this slide, this is one of the commercialized biosimilar product. I'm looking at a published paper in MAB. We're looking at the different attributes. You can see multiple attributes lined up here. Most of them are mass spec-based methods, and you can see that there are multiple attributes there, and the ranges that have been established or determined in both innovator as well as the biosimilar product. Number of lots that have been analyzed are around 2021. You can see that all highlighted by those red arrows, and there are about 3 to 4 batches which have been tested, which are biosimilar batches. And on your right side, you can see those dark blue and light blue panels. The dark blue panels show the range of the innovator molecule for that particular attribute, whereas the light blue box actually indicates the range of the biosimilar. throughout in all of the attributes, you can see that the light blue boxes are showing so small as against the dark blue rectangles, which means this is the kind of space the biosimilar occupies within the space of the innovator. So such is the expectation for the biosimilar stringency. Moving on to those are the quality attributes, and these are the potency attributes for the same for a similar kind of molecule. You see that the range of relative potency for the reference molecule acquired over so many years, maybe around 7 to 8 years, there is a shift in the the target of your potency, the target value of the potency, which may be construed as a moving target or I don't know what better way to say that, but the biosimilar over 3 to 4 years shows very consistent potency. So this is the kind of expectation for a biosimilar. Biosimilar also needs to show a pairwise comparability to your innovator product, which you source from US, innovator product, which you source from US. So different geographies, you need to map their space. Most often the space is similar. However, you still have to show that they are not different. So again, that is a lot of analytical work that is required. So the expectation on the analytical stringency and robustness is very high for a biosimilar, which will aid you to develop a biosimilar of good quality and of a very good business sense. So that's about the talk. I think in a nutshell, I've given you what is the expectation of a biosimilar and all the challenges. So the key takeaway from my talk is that biosimilars do not have the clinical space of an innovator product. So the innovator product goes through multiple levels of clinical trials, phase 1, 2, 3, 4. So the amount of space they have is not available to biosimilars because biosimilars go in with an abbreviated clinical trial. Therefore, the expectations of product quality and process consistency is much higher than the innovator product itself. Therefore, biosimilars should capitalize newer technology, and why not? Because they are chronologically much later than the innovator. So with a decade that passes, the expectations and of technology improvement is higher, and that's exactly what happens. So biosimilar companies should capitalize on the newer technology to develop efficient processes for manufacturing of biosimilars. So I think I'll wind up with this.
And I'll take it over for you. Thank you, Anita. Once again, I'd like to remind our viewers that there will be a live question and answer session at the end of the presentation. Please feel free to send in your questions at any time during the presentation via the questions tab located directly below your webinar screen, and we will go through these at the end of the presentation. Now please allow me to introduce our second speaker, Dr. Anu Uppal. Dr. Anu Uppal received her PhD in biotechnology from the Indian Institute of Toxicology Research, Lucknow, in 2004. And she did a postdoctoral fellowship in the School of Life Sciences, Jawaharlal Nehru University. Her experience led her to be a senior research associate with Applied Biosystems and then transitioning to global demo lead and advanced workflow specialist for biopharma applications at SciEx. Her work focuses on biotherapeutic characterization and quantitation workflows using LC-MS technologies. Dr. Uppal has more than 25 research papers and book chapters in peer-reviewed journals. I'll now be handing over to our second presenter. Welcome, Anu.
Thank you, Stephen, for the kind introduction. Good afternoon, everyone, and thanks for joining the webinar today. In the previous presentation, Dr. Anita has clearly outlined the importance of assessment of product attributes in the life cycle management of biotherapeutics. So today in my presentation, I'll be talking about the SciEx solutions which are available for high throughput monitoring of these product attributes using multi-attribute methodology and how this can potentially be used right from the discovery phase to development and all the way up to manufacturing and QC stage. So the very first question which comes to our mind is, what is MAM or multi-attribute methodology. So it is a high resolution accurate mass method for the biotherapeutic quality assessment in bottoms-up approach. So generally, when we do peptide mapping, in the peptide mapping approach, you're essentially monitoring a large number of attributes like glycosylation heterogeneity, C-terminal lysine variants, N-terminal modifications, oxidations, deamidations, and it is really important to understand their criticality and how they are affecting the safety and potency of the molecule. So these have the potential to improve your product quality. So this is MAM can be used as orthogonal assessment to conventional assays, and it can be a direct assessment of the attributes. And MAM, the multi-attribute method, is aligned with ICH guidelines in the complete product lifecycle management and using the quality by design approach. It certainly provides the analytical benefits across biopharmaceutical development. So what are these benefits? So as you know that for the monitoring of all these attributes, you need to use a multitude of assays. So like for example, in the right hand side of this table, we have described like a multitude of assays like deamidation, glycation, C-terminal lysine variants, host cell proteins. So you need to monitor all these PQAs in your for your molecule. And you use multitude of different assays. So here the green color denotes that it is the preferred choice, the preferred method for the assessment of this particular PQA. The yellow means that this particular test can be used, can potentially be used for the assessment. The red means it's not the preferred way or it cannot be done by using this method. So for example, like ELISA, so it is like the preferred way of doing the HCP assessment. So likewise, if you see here, the LC-MS-based multi-attribute method can be used for all these methods in one go. So this can provide most of the answers as compared to other assays. So we can say that multi-attribute method, it can reduce the number of tests, it can reduce the cost of development, and it gives the detailed view of quality profile. It gives you the totality of evidence as required by regulatory. So it is an expensive tool which can be implemented to multiple assays and thus reducing the test and the time needed, the number of tests needed, and the cost of overall development. So when we first started implementing MAM for in the LC-MS analysis, so obviously because it's a new technology, lot of challenges were faced. So the first challenges, what the challenges faced by the in the implementation of MAM is the complexity of the mass spectrometers. So it's a tuning and calibration. So it's often required that these mass spectrometers require a lot of tuning and calibration, setting up the acquisition method. It's not like fully automated and it needs expertise. Most of the time, the challenge phase is that you have to use multiple software packages and you need to transfer the data to Excel spreadsheets to get the complete picture. The most important challenge, or you can say that the initial pushback what was observed was the sample preparation. The sample preparation can induce certain modifications like oxidation and deamidations. It can generate inconsistent results regardless of scientists. So the major challenge was how this can be controlled. So this process-induced digestion artifacts, how we can reduce that. And then the need for non-targeted purity assessment. That is a fear of unknown. So it's always the question which comes to the mind is, are there any new changes happening in my molecule which is not there in the reference or control sample? And how effectively if there are any changes, how effectively we can highlight or flag out these changes. So you need a tool which can help you in flagging out these changes. So here is the complete solution what SciX has to offer, right from the hardware to software, for the complete assessment of MAM throughout the development process. So the first thing is the X500B QTOF, benchtop QTOF available, which is a simplified setup for the accelerated results and compact footprint. Then comes, so for the analysis, for the consistent results, you need to have a robust LC. So SciX offers Xeon UPLC with the ultra low downtime and kind of robustness needed for such analysis. SciX OS, so which is like easy to use and learn acquisition software, which is fully compliant, and then BioPharmaView software, which the all-in-one software for the complete MAM workflow. So I'll be discussing all these things one by one in later slides. So SciX X500B QTOF is a benchtop model, and it gives you the thermostability regulation and continuous mass accuracy without the need of calibration. So with the changes in the hardware design, we have made this system robust to give you the mass accuracy which is needed for such analysis. So it's a small footprint benchtop, simple hardware, but with robustness and ease of repair. It houses the Turbo V-Source, which is the patented SciX technology, and which provides excellent ionization efficiency and robustness for a wide range of flow rates. Then the SciX OS, so this is the acquisition software with the intuitive interface, which is easy to learn and use. So one simple interface has all its, the capabilities like acquisition for data processing and then the management. So it has definable user roles and it's completely 21 CFR Part 11 compliant. The most important thing here is that the system has automated instrument tuning. So you, for system calibration and tuning, the process is completely automated and easy to use. Then the BioPharmaView software. So this has a full-fledged MAM workflow where, right, starting from the beginning, you can define your PQAs, you can track your PQAs. So like you can create a list of the all the PQAs depending upon your reference standard. And then you can also do the review with automated quantitation of percent modification ratio for each particular attribute or each site. You can also monitor your known impurities. So if you know that there are certain host cell proteins or certain like sequence variants which are known to you, you can very well define them and detect them in the software. Then the purity testing. So here we have a workflow called new peak detection, so which allows for the detection of new peaks in the sample by performing differential analysis between the control and sample, so which were not there listed in your list of PQAs. So it will tell you if something new is coming up in your sample as compared to your reference standard or control standard. And then obviously the reporting. So it has a streamlined information transfer with customizable reporting in multiple output formats. So it has a feature if you want to have a concise report only for the PQAs assessed, or you want to have a full-fledged complete report with the sequence coverage matching and along with the PQAs asset. So there is an option you can do that. So what are the applications of MAM, where all we can use this this methodology? So typically, MAM or multi-attribute method can be used at any stage of the development cycle. So it can be used at the discovery phase, at the clone selection, to process development. So it can monitor specific molecule attributes at amino acid level. You can track the impact of process changes on the molecular properties. It can be used for stability assessment, any kind of post-translational modifications, formulations, post-degradations. And the same method which was used in the whole process at the initial stages of development, in the discovery or the development phase, the same can be applied to the QC, to the quality control. So the method, the knowledge what you gain during the discovery or the early phases of development can very well be used by using this MAM method for the release of the products in the compliant environment. So in the development of the biotherapeutics, the biggest challenge today is that only a small fraction of drug candidates enter the development phase end up becoming a commercial product. So what happens is that it involves a long time span and failure at later development phases where the cost involved are much higher. And the reason for this is, for this iteration, is that it is mainly related to the design and molecular characteristics of drug candidates in related to the manufacturing and delivery strategies. So the benefit of using multi-attribute method is that you can evaluate these things early and you can adjust accordingly. So it can, so if MAM is applied early in the early assessment of the product attribute, using that knowledge, you can use that knowledge for improving safety and potency and quality of the drug molecule. So MAM can potentially impact early risk assessment and help in the monitoring and managing these changes early and improve process development, and then help you by improving the cost involved by designing the optimal candidate with the desired product profile. So with the MAM approach, you can really reduce the cost involved and you can have the risk assessment early in the phase of development. So how we track, how we define and track these impurities? So the software has a very interactive interface where you can define your attributes and you can the calculated results will be presented immediately. So here the user has flexibility to define all the calculations. You can define what are the charge states you want to include, what are the peptides, so like miscleavage peptides if you want to include. So you have the flexibility to define your and develop a targeted list of attributes. So once you define the attributes, you have the capability to define the acceptance criteria for quantification of these attributes. So these acceptance criteria, if you have prior knowledge of your product, you can define that, or if you have, you know your reference standards, the ranges for the reference standards, you can define according to that. So there are multiple ways, like you can define a particular attribute to be in a plus minus of a defined percentage, greater than or equal to a defined value, or you can define an absolute range. So basically for pass, marginal, and fail for each attribute with respect to your control sample, you have the flexibility to define the values. It is up to you how stringent you want to evaluate. So like in the earlier presentation, Dr. Anita showed that for innovators, the reference ranges are quite wide. But for biosimilars in the development process, you need to have very stringent ranges. So here you have the complete flexibility with which you can define these reference ranges. And you also have the flexibility, like out of these many attributes, which one you want to include in the assay, or if any attribute which you think is not critical and you don't want to include in the list. So you have that flexibility. Then you have the option to create the batch. So once you create the list, you define your ranges, you can create a batch. And this can be your TOPMS data. This can be your IDA, which is the information dependent or data dependent acquisition data. Or you can use the SWAT-MS data. So SciEx has a proprietary technology called SWAT, which is the data independent mode of acquisition. So the benefit is that you do not define any filtering criteria in the SWAT acquisition. So it helps in the identification of all those low level of attributes without any bias. And here, then you can also define one of the sample as a control, which will be used as a reference for the new peak detection. So here we have performed certain studies to showcase the power of multi-attribute method. And like I mentioned earlier, one of the initial pushback for the implementation of MAM method was to ensure the consistency of the results across multiple instruments and multiple analysts. Because when we implement MAM, it has to be consistent across different sample sets or across different instruments. So here we have analyzed the NIST standard antibody, and using the same LC-MS methodology, we acquired the data across different SciEx labs. We used NIST as a standard because it can be used as an authenticated standard for the development of MAM workflow. And this can also help you in setting up the system suitability method for your lab. So here what we observed that the different glycoforms we monitored in NIST antibody were very well within the defined range, and it was fairly consistent across the labs. What I would like to highlight here is that the glycoform percentages, what was observed, were very well in accordance with the glycan release assays. So the MAM data was fairly consistent across all the labs for glycoforms. So like we mentioned earlier, that MAM has the potential to be used in force degradation studies or stability studies. So here what we did is we incubated the digest in different pH conditions. So like in order to know your variance, you have to have the knowledge about how your molecule is behaving in different pH. So what we did is we incubated the sample in different pH, right from slightly acidic 6.8 to pH 8.8, which is alkaline. So here again, the green one shows that the pH, the percentage modification for a particular pH is very well within the defined limit. The red circles denote that this is going beyond the difference ranges. So this way you can very well track the different attributes, how they are behaving for a particular position or under different conditions. So we also performed another study for oxidation. As you know, like oxidation is another modification or attribute which needs to be monitored. So what we did is we incubated the antibody sample in hydrogen peroxide to accelerate the process of oxidation. And then we performed the time course study from 30 minutes to 24 hours. And we tracked all the methionine and tryptophan oxidations using the MAM workflow. We also repeated the same thing at the subunit level, just to correlate the data. What we are observing in the bottoms-up approach is matching with the subunit approach. So here, like we monitored different oxidation positions, the methionines, the tryptophans, and again here you can see the green ones are well within the range. The red circles denotes that this particular position is quite susceptible to oxidation, and it shows a percentage increase in the oxidation level when incubated with the hydrogen peroxide. The yellow triangle denotes that it is a marginal value, so it is lying at the marginal level. So with this study, you can easily come to know like this particular modification, this particular position is not that much susceptible to changes in the oxidation, whereas some of these positions are fairly susceptible to the oxidation levels. So here is an example. So one of the benefit what we have with the software is that you get the complete information in one single intuitive workflow. So here you can compare your control and oxidize at the TIC level, at the MS level, at XIC, MSMS, all in one go. And like here you can see this particular light chain methionine at position 4 is showing some levels of oxidation. Here is another example where the heavy chain peptide, DTLMISR, so which is the most common position 255, which undergoes oxidation. And you can see the it is very much clear that this is very much susceptible to the oxidation because it is showing almost similar levels of like approximately 50% going under oxidation. The same data, what we observed was correlated at the subunit level. So here you can see that the oxidation, the LC region is not that much susceptible to the oxidation in the presence of peroxide, whereas the same thing in FC region is quite susceptible. So as was evident with the peptide approach using MAM. So here you can see the how the percentage level of oxidation is increasing with different percentages of hydrogen peroxide during the time course study. Another thing is the system has the capability to isotopically resolve the peaks at the subunit level. So here you can see like clearly observed that for LC, FD and FC region, the isotopes are fairly resolved. So the system has such a high resolution that you can resolve these peaks and you can accurately identify the masses which will help you in confirmation that yes, oxidation is happening. And this the complete data set correlates very well with the multi-attribute method data. So in summary, the SciEx offers a complete MAM workflow from characterization to attribute monitoring. For successful MAM analysis, it should be easy to use, reproducible and robust LC-MS system. So which with SciEx X500B QTOF and Exeon UPLC, we offer a robust and reproducible LC-MS solution. To monitor the CQA successfully, a single efficient software tool is beneficial. So BioPharmaView offers a single software solution where you can define your CQAs, you can define your custom calculations, you can define your pass-fail criteria, reference ranges, and the new peak detection. So it does tell you that if there is something new in your sample with respect to control. So it very well flags out the differences what are there. So it can help you in overcoming the unknown of fear. So that's all from my side. Thank you.
Thank you, Anu. Now we will begin the question and answer segment of the webinar. But once again, I would like to remind the audience that you can still send in your questions via the questions tab directly below your webinar screen. Now our first question is availability of product variants are critical to map structure functions relationships. What should one do if it is not available?
Yeah, Stephen, I will take that question. So availability of variants is very important to map the structure function relationship. But if your process, normally these variants are produced by the process, so then it becomes these impurities or variants are representative of your particular process. Now, sometimes we are looking at certain quality attributes which we know are critical in nature, but if it is not found in the molecule, you need to generate it according to some conditions of extreme pH, extreme temperature, or agitation, you know, various kinds of stress. So these are stress conditions that may be encountered by your product during its generation, storage, shipping, during cold chain, during any of these times. It's possible that your molecule will also reach this kind of a condition. So that's another way of looking at product variants and impurities. There are some places where, for example, if your molecule has a whole lot of sialic acids, and if you want a product variant with lower sialic acid or higher sialic acid, you may want to meddle with the cell culture conditions to produce such a product so that you know the impact of the right product. You will always know what is right when you know what is wrong. So you need to have a negative control to know that your result is actually positive. Many of these trace variants, which never occur, like something like sequence variants or immunogenic variants, if the product has a history of producing such kind of variants and very trace levels, and if you're not able to see this variant in your product, you may want to artificially generate them, either by actually cloning those kind of variants, you know, so you know what would be the impact even if such a variant is actually present in the product. Impurities are as important as your product itself to demonstrate that your product is actually correct. So it's very important to generate impurities and variants early on, save them, to show method sensitivity, to show the product is right, to show the product delivers, you really need all the negatives. So they are as critical as your product itself.
Thank you. Our next question is, should every identified critical quality attribute be a part of the final process strategy?
No, not necessarily. If you have identified critical quality attributes, and if your process does not have a capability to control it, then there is no point having that as your process control strategy. In fact, you will not be able to do it. So there are some interactions that happen between the CQAs. For example, you may have HCPs, which are critical. You may also have CLIPs, which are critical. And you may have certain proteases, which are coming from the host cell. So these are HCPs that are present with the product, which will clip your product and produce your low molecular weight impurity. So these are interactions of CQAs that are present together in your product. There may also be certain CQAs that are important with respect to stability of the product. It may not be there in your product, may not be a part of your process-related impurity. However, it may be generated in terms of long-term stability. So you may have to look at certain quality attributes as critical because of the implications on stability. So the control strategy can be partly independent of your critical quality. You may be controlling a subset of your critical quality attributes in your process control strategy. In addition to certain important process controls, so there are process controls which are in general monitoring or controlling the process. So those are in addition to the strategy that only looks at quality. So it's basically a combination of all. So the answer is every identified critical quality attribute need not be a part of your final process control strategy. It's more an intelligent design of the most required elements which go into the final process control strategy. Thank you.
Thank you. Our next question is, I saw green checks, orange diamonds, and red circles for the reference ranges defined. Can I set my own value?
Yeah, so this question I'll take. So yes, you can define your own values, and so it's like when you start early in the development process, you know that that these are the reference values. Or if you are working on the biosimilar, so based on your innovator knowledge,
you know that these are the reference values in the innovator and your biosimilar. To show that as a highly similar, you can define the similar ranges. So you have the complete flexibility of defining these ranges as per your own requirement.
Our next question is, I saw you mentioned HCPs as PQA assessments. Does this software handle that? HCP is in the area of our concern.
If you know, there are certain known HCPs, so those can be easily defined into the software as impurities. However, we have a different, complete, like sophisticated workflow for the HCP discovery kind of a workflow. But in case if you know, you are aware of that these are the HCPs or these are the impurities which you are looking for, those can be easily defined.
Thank you. Our next question is, you mentioned SWAS in your talk. Does this use DDA or SWAS, and what does SWAS do for you?
So, okay, I guess this is the question again for me. So here the workflow is very, very flexible. So you can use either data-dependent acquisition or you can use the SWAT acquisition, which is the data-independent acquisition. So there are obviously some real advantages of using SWAT in this workflow. The first thing is, like, it creates a digital archive of your sample. So in case you are looking for a particular attribute today, and you want to reinterrogate the data after 6 months or a year, so you don't have to really require the data from the same batch, because batch what you are analyzing today will not be available after 6 months. So it's like you just have to go back and just interrogate the data, so you'll get your answers. The second point is that in SWAT, there is no filtering criteria. So you don't really have to define any criteria for triggering the MSMS on a precursor. So even for the low level of modifications, impurities, you always get the great results. So unlike IDA or information dependent acquisition, where you define certain thresholds for precursor triggering. So in SWAT, that's not the case. So these are the advantages of using SWAT for this particular workflow.
Thank you. Just one more time, I would like to remind our audience that you can send any questions during the question and answer segment via the questions tab located directly below your webinar screen. Thank you. Our next question is, does BPV 3.0 have features that are well suited to biosimilar development?
So, Biopharma View can handle all types of different workflows. So it's not just that you can do your innovator or a single molecule. You can do the batch processing for all different kinds of workflows. So it can very well do the intact comparisons, peptide mapping, despite doing all these CQA assessments.
Thank you. Again, for you, Dr. Anu, you showed that the software can find new impurities. How does that work?
Okay, so for the impurity assessment, what you can do is you can define one sample as a control and other as the samples. And the software algorithm will then find out and flag out the differences. So it does kind of a differential analysis, and then it will flag out based on the, it's like you can define a real threshold of looking for the new peaks, which were not there earlier in the control sample. So based on that, it does the differential analysis and gives out floods out the new peak if they are coming in this sample. We do have other tools outside of BPP available where this will help in identification of those new species.
One more for you. This seems quite focused on MABs. We work on other proteins as well. Does this software work for other types of protein therapeutics?
Oh, yes, very well. So this can handle all the MABs. We showed here examples of monoclonal antibodies because those are the like molecules of interest most of the time. But BPV can handle any different kind of therapeutic protein, ADCs, antibody drug conjugates, pegylated proteins, small proteins, any kind of molecule.
Thank you. And our final question seems like it's for Agnew once more. It sounds like Sciasig Solutions is aimed at CQA or PQA definition and monitoring. Does it also have the ability to do critical process parameter definition and monitoring?
That's a very good question. And I'd like to say the answer is yes. So BPV Biopharma View 3 for multi-attribute method is aimed primarily at the CQA monitoring. Though I did not show that, but we do have a complete hardware and software solutions that can be used for targeted CPP monitoring.
Thank you. And with that, we'll close the question and answer segment. So if you have anything to add, you may. Well, before we close the webinar, I would like to ask our presenters, Anita and Anu, once more, if they have any closing remarks.
No, thanks, Stephen.
Thank you. Thank you. Go ahead, Anu.
Yeah, and thanks for the audience for joining today. Thank you.
Thank you, Stephen. Thanks to Adam for arranging this webinar, and thanks, Anu, for working together with Nitin.
Well, thank you both. I would like to take this opportunity to thank our presenters, Anita Krishnan and Anu Upal, for sharing their knowledge with us. And I would like to remind our audience that you can view this and other webinars on demand by visiting biopharma-asia.com/on-demand-webinars. Thank you, everyone. Have a great day.